All right, folks, we're going to go ahead and get started. Let's open in a word of prayer. Father, we are so thankful tonight for those that you've raised up to do your work. We're thankful for those that have come tonight to hear your word. And Lord, we just we pray that you'll be with us as we look at this very intricate and involved work of figuring out exactly and discerning when we're to get involved and how we're to get involved, and Lord, just how to be guided and directed by your Spirit and your Word. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right. Everybody here is already aware, but why a conference? Invite some people. Elva's got some more cards there if you want any cards to invite. If you invite people and they're willing to give you their address, we'll send them one of these cards as a reminder to come. And our team will actually address them and get them out for you. You don't even have to send them out. So all of that's good stuff. Things are progressing along there. Looks like we'll have a good turnout in Eureka, I think. I think we'll have a good turnout there and a lot of churches involved. So here is the text that we're involved with tonight, James chapter 1, verse 27. If you have your Bible or you want to grab one out of the back of the seat there, open up your Bible on your cell phone, however you want to look at it. I think I did the ESV version here, so if you would rather read another translation, you're welcome to do that as I read this. And James 1:27 says this, "Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world." So let's take that apart in some pieces here, and I'm not going to do a detailed exegesis, but let me just give you some insight before we get to the actual question. This is the text at hand. And then you'll see the question that comes out of this, which was the question that was sent in on a 3x5 card, questions from the pews, that's y'all. 3x5 cards, write out your questions. Make sure they're theological questions. I don't have any idea where the sewer is for this church, okay? So those kind of questions can go to somebody else. But I'm a funny guy, Pastor Tom. For my granddaughter this week, I had silly string. I was spraying her with silly string, so now she says, "Silly, silly, papa, silly, silly." Religion that is pure and undefiled before God. Sometimes we can get it in our heads that we have figured this thing out, and we know what our faith should look like and how we should live out our faith, but is it pure and undefiled before God? That's the real question. Is it only pure and undefiled in my mind? Well, if I've got the wrong understanding of who God is, that's a very easy thing to do. My faith can be pure and undefiled in my mind, but be not so pure and undefiled in the sight of God. So, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, James 1:27 says, to visit widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world. So the first part of that, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction, essentially in the idea of the day, when you heard that kind of a phrase, it would have been everything encompassed with that kind of an idea. In other words, it's service in the community. It is reaching out to share our faith in a pragmatic, palatable, real way. So that's what that whole line is about. It's not just visiting widows and orphans, but it is more than that. It is doing the things that are practical to show our faith. And you remember, James is the book that is so practical. The first book I ever read all the way through of the Bible was the book of James. And I'll tell you where I was. I know exactly where I was and what version of the Bible I was reading at the time. I was going to visit Elva. She was in Florida at her uncle's house. And I was traveling on a bus, and I'd missed my connection. And I was in a bus stop in Orangeburg, South Carolina, which is about that big. And they had a little newsstand there. And they had all the newspapers there, and they had a couple of books, and one of them was the New Living Translation of the Bible, which was fresh off the press. It had just come out. And I picked it up, and I went back to the chair there, and I was so tired, and I didn't know when I was going to catch the next bus. I laid down, and I used it as a pillow. And when I woke up, I picked it up, and I just opened the Bible, and it was the book of James, and I read it straight through. And it is a... To me, it was one of the most powerful, practical books in all of the Bible. It tells you how we ought to live, be living every day. Yeah, there's one here and there's one back there. Yeah. The book of James is putting your faith into action. And you'll remember there in the book of James, we see James talking about faith without works is dead. That our faith without practical application is a dead faith. We have no faith essentially if there's not practical action put behind it. And so that's that part. And then it says, and keep oneself unstained from the world, to not let the world encroach into our faith to the point that it stains it or drains it out of you. That we're not so involved in worldly things and caught up with worldly ideas and thoughts and practices and habits and hobbies, that we get so caught up in those things that it stains our faith. Now, what do we mean by that? Well, if it is staining or taking away from our practical application of our faith, then it is staining what we ought to be living out before God, and what we ought to be living out in His name. So, to keep oneself unstained from the world, and who is keeping himself unstained? To keep ourselves, yeah. It's not okay. I'll go to church, and it's the pastor's job to keep it unstained, or it's the Sunday school teacher's job to keep it unstained. You know, it's not the trustee's job to keep it unstained. It's your job to keep it unstained. That's it. All comes back to my application for my life. So this is the text that was referenced in the question. Here's the question. I wrote it down word for word. The church's responsibility begin and end in regards to meeting the physical needs of the poor in James 1:27, only referring to the poor within the body or the poor outside of the body of Christ. So is it just talking about poor people inside the church, or is it talking about poor people in the community? Poor people in Africa? Where are those boundaries? How do we lay that out? So that's the gist of the question. Now, let me just tell you, with a question like this, there are always what I call a whole series of sub-questions that have to be answered before you can answer that question. And so we're going to go to the sub-questions now. The questions that have to be answered before you answer the big question. And here are some of those sub-questions. The question within the question has to do with stewardship. What is Christian stewardship? Christian stewardship has more to do with you than just your money. I know that, you know, if you've heard sermons on stewardship, the focus is normally on money. And certainly that's a part of stewardship. But that's not all of stewardship. I'm a steward of my time. I'm a steward of other things that God has given me as resources. This building is an asset for which the trustees are stewards. They are stewards over this facility. How is it going to be used? How is it being cared for? Are we doing our best to keep it up and not only make it presentable, but make it functional? Are we doing the best we can with what God has given us? We don't have to stretch beyond what God's given us in the congregation, because it's Christ that's building the church. It's each one of our responsibilities to fulfill the role he's called us to. So stewardship goes beyond the question of just money. And so I want you to keep that in mind as we talk about the poor. Because here's the catch. Quite often, throwing money at a problem is the easiest solution from the outside to fix the problem, but rarely does it fix the problem. It takes real effort. The organizational meeting we just had for the Y conference, what if we just said, well, everybody just come and do what you want to do. If you want to, you know, what? I don't think we'll print any cards if y'all want to just write on a card why and put them out there. You know, it takes real effort to put these things together. It's not, and you know, we've done them for years, and I can tell you, we do more work in the preparation and in the debrief afterwards, because what we'll do is when this is all over, we'll sit down and I'll ask you, every one of you that are involved in this, what could we have done better? What could I have done better? I want you to think about what I'm doing that night. What could I do better the next week? Because I need to be fine-tuning this. If I'm not communicating in a way that is practical and people's lives can be changed by that, I need to know that. If we could have done something better in here, we need to know that for the next one up there on Saturday. But it also will help us with the very next thing we do, because I'm keeping notes of all of those things. I can show you debriefs that we did 10 years ago in Africa. We brought the whole team back, and I got the prayer team that stayed on the state side, and I said, okay, what did you guys do? What could have been better? How did you go about it? And then the team that was in Africa, what did we do? The team that received us in Africa and provided our housing and all of that kind of stuff, I did the same thing with them. And then all of those things are part of our stewardship. All of that is part of how we are using what God has given us, and part of what God has given us is us. You know, are we using the giftedness of the people here? The second thing that we're going to talk about tonight is judging. Everybody's heard the text from Matthew 7 and 8 that gets into, and if anybody is not a churchgoer, they can quote you this scripture. Judge not, lest you be not judged. If they've never been to church in their life, they'll go, don't you judge me. The Bible says, don't you judge me. So we're going to talk about that tonight, but is there a difference between judging in that sense and discerning what needs to be done with the facts that are on the table? And when we look at that whole text from Matthew, you're going to see the very next sentence after it says, judge not, that seems to be there's judgment going on. And God is saying, don't throw pearls before swine. Well, who's going to decide whether they're swine or not? Somebody's going to have to be judging, aren't they? That's discernment. So there's got to be some discerning going on here to answer that first question. There's got to be stewardship. There's got to be discerning. The third thing is a theology of money. I'm going to give you two different rampantly growing theologies that are out there. And one of them you may have heard of before. The other one you may not have heard of before. One's called the poor gospel, and the other one is called liberation theology. P-O-O-R, poor gospel and liberation theology. And I'll talk about those as we get to them. But it will show you what people have done, taking God's word out of its context to create a whole system of how they're going to live around one text ripped from its context. And the whole focus of this is poor people, abused people, people that feel like they've been abused either by society or the government or the church or whatever. Okay? So a theology of money comes into this. And then, am I enabling a problem or am I empowering somebody to get past that problem? So when we're talking about dealing with the poor, we've got to ask ourselves these questions. And that last one goes back to some of that discerning part. By what I'm getting ready to do, am I making the problem worse or am I making it better? Am I ultimately building in somebody relying on a handout, or am I working toward helping that person become more self-sufficient? Now, here's the problem. It's easier to throw money at that question than it is to get involved and become a mentor to a person to help them through where they are. And then discerning, is this a person that even wants the help? So all of these things come in. You see how the background of this and these questions have to be answered before you get to some of this. And then the last one is, is it a head decision, a heart decision, or is it a head and heart decision? And I would say this, if it's only a heart decision, you're going on emotions, you'll probably make the wrong decision. If it's only a head decision and you're making the decision just with your head, you'll probably make the wrong decision. It's a head and a heart decision as to what you do to reach out to help people in the community. I see people all the time and my heart breaks for them. And I don't know what their situation is. But before I just throw money at that problem, I should know what their situation is. I should know something about their desire to make things better. Or is this just a preference that they have to not spend money on a house or food or whatever in order to support a drug habit? What am I getting ready to enable here? Does all that make sense? Okay. So let's look at all these things. Let's watch this little video. You're going to have to turn that volume up. You ready? Okay. Does God want us to be rich? Turn it up.
Does God want us to be rich? In this video, I will share with you why, even though we have been giving the correct answers to this question, we still haven't been able to find a practical solution. And then, as a bonus, I will offer you the better solution. Does God want us to be rich? To answer this question, it only makes sense that we go back to the Bible. But how do we approach this question? Well, the simplest way would be to look at the life of Jesus. After all, he is our most perfect example. So then, we asked, was Jesus rich or poor? While we do not know for certain the exact amount of money that Jesus and his disciples carried around with them in the money bag, chances are, based on all the evidence in Scripture, he was closer to being poor than rich. So if Jesus was poor, and the disciples were poor, then it must be his will that we, Christians, should be poor as well. Which makes sense when you look at all the tragedy around the world, and the fact that the majority of Christians also appear to be poor and suffering. This also seems to line up nicely with the suffering Christians in the Bible, not to mention the number of bad things that happen when money shows up, evidenced by all the warnings in the Bible about money. So, that's it then. Case closed. Easy, right? Actually, it's not so easy. Why? Because nobody wants to be poor. Think of this. When was the last time you spoke to your child and gave them this good counsel? You know, Johnny, when you grow up, your mother and I would really like it if you would try to be poor. You know, like Jesus. After all, this is what God wills for us. No, we don't say that. It sounds dumb. You see, regardless of what you believe about this question, we spend our entire lives trying to ensure that both ourselves and those we love do not experience poverty. So how can we then pat ourselves on the back and claim to believe that Jesus wants us to be poor. I'm not saying that he wants us to be poor. I'm just saying he doesn't want us to be rich. You see, this type of logic leads us to Christian stewards who do not love Jesus enough to be poor and do not love money enough to be rich. And so we go through life just existing, doing nothing to increase the resources that he has entrusted us for the advancement of his kingdom. Jesus describes the state of neither increasing or decreasing as being a wicked and slothful servant, according to the parable of the talents. Don't want to be that servant that has nothing to offer God when he returns? I have a better solution. Everything that you have heard and read in the Bible is true, but we are still failing to find a solution to this question because we have been giving the correct answers but asking the wrong questions. Instead of asking, does God want us to be rich or poor, let's ask the correct question. Does God want us to be successful in our mission? Now let's look at our logic. Was Jesus successful in his mission? Yes, by all means he was successful in the purpose for why he came. And he expects us to be successful as well. Better yet, he promises to help us if we trust and follow his plan. No, God has not purposed that every Christian should be rich. In fact, there are many who have been blessed with the ability to influence and emotionally connect with others, and they should grow these talents for use in God's kingdom. But there are also those who have been blessed with the ability to create affluence, and they should grow those talents for use in funding God's kingdom as well. God doesn't want you to be poor. God wants you to be a successful steward in his kingdom. God has a plan for your life. Are you living it?
So, stewardship has to do with our resources, the resources we've been given. That's money we have, other things we have. We had in North Carolina, the first time we lived there, we had a guest house that was actually my office. And when we had missionaries come to the United States, that's where missionaries stayed. That was God's resource, and that's where missionaries stayed, was at our guest house. They had a private place with their own kitchen, their own living room, their own bedroom, and a pretty decent library to boot. So, that was God's resource. Everything that we have is a resource that can be used for God's kingdom. So the talents that you've got, the abilities that you've got, the spiritual gifts, that's the reason we started some time ago talking about individual spiritual gifts and how you can be used in God's kingdom. So there's three areas we want to talk about. I want to talk about the poor, poverty. What do we do in our own community with that issue? The issue of liberation theology, and then the whole thing about judge not. And I want you to see that all of this works together to come up with the answer to the question that was asked tonight. What do we do with the poor in our community? How far do we go? Where does our responsibility as church, as the church, and that's us in here, that's not the building, that's us in here, the church, how far do we go? Where does it begin? Where does it end? And our responsibility. So let's talk about some of these things just so we understand. The Old Testament's view of poverty and the responsibility. At times the Bible gives a very simple explanation of why people are rich or poor. If a person delights in the law of the Lord, he or she will get wealth and riches. Such people will prosper in everything they do, Psalm 1:3 and 112:3. With regard to Israel in Old Testament days, these ideas are not quite so naive as they might seem. There was indeed a connection between sin and poverty that you see made a direct corollary in the Old Testament. Israelite society was built on rules laid down by God, so if there was poverty, that must mean that somewhere the rules were being broken. Does that mean the individual that was in poverty was responsible necessarily for the rules being broken? No. Because we were also given the responsibility to care for the poor. So it may be us that are in denial here. And part of the responsibility, even in those early days of the Old Testament, where the stigma of somebody who was poor was such that they had an antagonistic relationship with God. But yet God's people were to be different than the culture, even in the Old Testament. And God's people in the New Testament were to be different than the culture. We're not to be like the world. We're to live in the world but not be of the world. And that goes back to the Old Testament as well. Whether a person's poverty was due to his or her own sin or to someone else's, the Old Testament saw it as an evil to be combated. So that's the first thing. Poverty is an evil to be combated. The question is, what are we to do about it? How are we to deal with the issue? Is everybody we see living on the street a target for a handout? No, I don't think they are. And we're going to get into why that is in just a moment. But that's what this is saying. So there is an evil to be combated. The question is, how do we combat it? And again, often to throw money at an issue is the easiest thing we do. The hardest thing we do is real ministry to help that problem get resolved. It's the same thing is true in the church. To teach good theology is real work. It takes effort. It takes a lot of work to do a good job teaching biblical concepts. Now, I've talked to every pastor in this area over the last month about this upcoming Why conference. And I'm amazed at two things that are normative. You have one kind of pastor that, like myself, is very concerned about the studying, making sure that they're handling God's Word appropriately every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, and every Wednesday night. And then you have those that just kind of stand up and say whatever comes in their head, and they'll give a defense for that. Both kinds feel very reasoned in what they're doing. But only one falls under the biblical mandate that this is a heavy responsibility. Well, to actually work with somebody, to mentor somebody out of a poverty situation is real work. It's hard. And Pastor Tom can tell you from his work at the mission, it's also heartbreaking. It because a lot of times people don't want what they'll tell you they want. They'll tell you what they think you want to hear. And that's where the discernment and judging to do the right thing at the right time, spending our efforts in the most appropriate way, in the most beneficial way, to the most people, is what we've got to be looking at. I had to learn the hard way. There are people in churches that I've pastored that told me they wanted to learn to teach. And I can tell you after just one or two meetings, they didn't want to learn to teach. They wanted to teach. They didn't want to learn to teach. I can tell you there are people that say, well, I'll help with that ministry, and that's the last you ever see of them. All of those things are true. So part of that is the discerning part. Part of that is finding out who will step up and who won't step up. But part of that, when you're talking about people you don't know well, is a great deal of discernment to figure out where you're going to invest your time, because that is what you are steward over. You are steward over your gifts, your time, your abilities, all of your resources. You are a steward over all of those things. And you're, who are you answerable to? You're answerable to God for that. It's not to me. It's not to the church leadership. It's not to your family. You're answerable to God for that. How am I going to spend my time, and how is it going to best be spent for to resources for God? God cared for the needy, and he expected his people to do the same. So the real question now is, how do we do that? So I want to talk about some of these other issues with regard to liberation theology and some of that. But let's look at some Old Testament instruction concerning poverty, because this is God's word concerning some of the issues we've already talked about. There's no doubt that poverty's reach is both widespread and it's devastating today. All you've got to do is walk out on the streets here, but I can take you to some places in the world that you have never seen poverty like that except in pictures. And let me tell you, when you're there and you see the sights and you smell the smells, it's different than glossies in a magazine. You know, I've got a picture of me that I never will forget. And I'm squatted down, and it's a little girl in front of me, and she's got on a Mickey Mouse t-shirt that no doubt came from America, and it's filthy dirty, and it's ripped out in the front with a big triangular rip out of the front. But Mickey is showing on one side, and I can still remember the smell of sitting there and holding that little girl as I had my picture made with her. That's poverty. And we're called to answer the call. The question is, what is the best use of our time, energy, effort, money, talents, and abilities, and gifts? How can we best do that? And how do we do that as a church? Because that's part of our responsibility as a body. And how do we do that as individuals? Well, most of the time I've found that if we're doing it as a church, then individuals are getting involved to get that done. And the individuals are getting involved that are going to be involved anyway. So, and the leadership of the church can help guide some of these things with regard to resources and time and energy and effort into appropriate places. Because just like we were planning the Why conference back here a little bit ago, when we sit down all of us together and we say, okay, here's what we've got. Here's what we've got in resources in terms of money. Here's what we've got in the talents and the spiritual gifts of the individual sitting here. And here's the mammoth job that's out there that between all of us, as we talk about it together and we pray about it together, we will come up, just like we did at the Why conference a little bit ago, we'll come up with better answers than I will individually or any one of us will individually. We'll begin to hone out what it is we need to be doing as a body. And so that's what this is all about. God's people cannot be indifferent toward those in need because his expectations for us in regard to taking care of his poor are woven throughout the entire scripture. For example, look at the Lord's words about the goodness of King Josiah. In Jeremiah 22:16, he defended the cause of the poor and needy, and so all went well. Is that not what it means to know me, declares the Lord? So God is admonishing and saying, this is a direct result of knowing me. As far as I can tell, and I've talked to a lot of medical people, there's no such thing as a good gene. Gene. There's not a gene that's within somebody that just goes, that's the goodness in you. That's where your goodness comes from. There's a gene in you that's the good gene. Other people don't have that. They got a bad gene. No, it is through the Lord leading us and the Lord indwelling us that we even have a desire to be a part of doing something to reach out. Now, does that mean that people that don't have the Lord don't reach out? No, they do. Here's what I would question there. And I'm only throwing it out as a question. I'm not making any suggestion here. I'm throwing it out as a question. What is their motivation? I've talked to a lot of Jewish people that will tell you, this is part of the tradition of my culture. This is why I do these good things. The tradition of my culture should not be dictating what I do, but the heart of the Lord that is within me is what is really going to get the work done. So a lot of good work's going on, there's no doubt. And a lot of different groups and organizations and Some of them are secular organizations. Some of them are religious organizations. A lot of good work going on. My question is, what does the Lord want us to do? And I've always gone under this premise. Whatever we do should give us an opportunity to share our faith. Whatever we do, if we build houses, if we build churches, if we go out on the street and hand out a sandwich, whatever it is we do should give us an opportunity to share Jesus with someone, because he's the reason for us going out and doing what we do. So real ministry is caring for the poor in more than just their physical needs. Did everybody hear that? More than just in their physical needs. We can get so hung up on just the teaching of God's Word, or just a physical need that's there, or whatever it might be that would pull us away and get our attention. But we need to be careful that whatever we're doing is reaching across the bounds of all of those things, and ultimately we're sharing Christ with people because we want to be able to tell them, this is the reason we do what we do. I don't know why Habitat for Humanity does what they do, but this is the reason we do what we do. He defended the cause of the poor and the needy, and so all went well. Is that not what it means to know me, declares the Lord? And Moses instructed his people how to treat the poor and the needy. He said, give generously to them and do so without a grudging heart. Then because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hand to. Deuteronomy 15:10. So giving and doing these things with the right heart. With the right heart. See, because I can't see your motives. That's also something I can't see. I can look and I can say, okay, Carol and Linda are doing this. They're going out and doing outreach. And I heard them up here Sunday, and I think I got a glimpse of their heart in all of that. But ultimately, only God can look inside and go, that's what this is all about. That's what really this is all about. And that's what's being done here. God is saying, here's an opportunity for us to show Christ before a lost and a dying world. Now, if I'm going to show Christ before a lost and a dying world, I want to repeat again, it's important to us, it should be important to all of us as the church, that we're not enabling somebody just to live a lifestyle that is degrading to them as those who are created in the image of God, or is demoralizing to those around them, or is hurtful to themselves or others, but that rather we're doing something to help bring them to a saving knowledge of Christ and lift them out of that situation, whatever it is. I had a guy just a week or so ago that's a friend of Farron's that came in my office and sat down and had a conversation with him for, I don't know, 35, 45 minutes. And I met with his pastor this morning. And he goes, well, you know, what are we going to do about this guy? I said, well, he's your parishioner. I can tell you what I would do, but I can't tell you what to do. He's your parishioner. And it's not my first-hand responsibility, but it is my responsibility as a child of God, that if he shows back up, I'm going to do everything I can to be of benefit to him. But ultimately, that person has to make the decision. I want to genuinely be helped out of the situation I'm in. Because if they're not willing to do that, first thing I do when I sit down with a couple with a marriage problem, here's the very first thing I do. I'll sit down across the table from them where I can look them in the eye, and I ask them this. Do you, husband, do you really want to fix this? Or are you just here to get this checked off the list? Do you really want to fix this? Do you want it to be better? And then I'll look at her and I'll ask her the same question. Do you want this to be fixed? Do you want a marriage with this man? Or do you really want it fixed? Because if they don't want that, then there's no use for me to go any further. And a lot of times, you'd be surprised how many times people will look right at you and either lie to you, or the one of them will look at you and go, I want to fix it, and the other one will look at you and go, no, I don't want this guy. I'm just here to get this off my list, and I'm here to be able to say I went to the preacher. He couldn't fix it, so now I've done my duty. Really? Lots of times. But that's the issue here. Does a person that you find in a particular situation want your help? At what point, because we're going to get to the scripture in a moment, at what point are you casting pearls before swine? At what point are you helping a dog return to its vomit? And at what point, then, can you really be of assistance in bringing glory to God and helping a person by mentoring them out of the situation they're in? All of those are the kind of things we want to ask tonight. So the question is, then, who are the poor and needy, and who want the help? Ought there to be a different response in our stewardship for those who refuse to work and choose a lifestyle of seeking a handout, preferring to spend whatever money they have on things that are harmful to them physically or spiritually? At what point do we say, I'm willing to assist, and at what point do we say, I'm not willing to assist? At what point am I feeding their belly so that they can take their money and shoot it in their arm? Or at what point am I helping a husband stay home in order and really working to try to help him stay in the house and convincing the wife that he needs to be there in order for him to stay home and abuse his children?
Myself and a couple other guys at the house managers at the mission today were discussing this very thing about 4 o'clock this afternoon. Pardon?
I bet you do.
But what takes place there is there are a lot of the homeless bunch all over Eureka, who, especially the guys, who come in as guests at the mission, and they stay at the mission. Sometimes they're almost like regular guests. And the address they use is the address. And between the 2nd and 5th of every month, they get their checks of one kind or another. And in the mail today was a stack of envelopes about this thick. And I'm standing there and just greeting the mail person when he comes and thanked him for coming down here and, you know, and handing him some literature about the mission and stuff like that. And the fellow who was checking that stuff in was just shaking his head. And he said, I know I should not be this way. But he said, every one of these envelopes has a check in it. And we're going to give it to these guys that come in tonight that we're feeding and taking care of every night. And we charge them absolutely nothing. A lot of them are going to use this money to go buy drugs,
yeah,
or hire a prostitute or whatever. Yeah. And so, I mean, it's that dilemma that we really battle at every month.
These are hard, hard questions.
Yeah.
And they're not easily answered. It's not like tonight I'm going to give you a formula that you go plug the factors into the formula and it comes out the other end. This is exactly what you do, because this is a discernment issue. This is a prayer issue. This is something that you should spend time in God's Word and with God about. If you've got a heart for somebody, make sure your heart doesn't get ahead of your head or vice versa. Because sometimes my head just says, cut it off. I mean, I'm finished. And my heart's going, but. And then sometimes my heart gets ahead of my head and I'm out there doing things I shouldn't be doing before I think about it. So all of these are really, really difficult issues. We just need to make sure that we're doing things according to God's Word. according to the gifts that we have, and in a place that they're going to have a return for the kingdom. Because what are we doing out there? We should be looking at this as I am God's workmanship, created in His image for His good works. For His good works. And if it's just my good works, it means nothing. If it's His good works through me, it means everything. So getting to that place that we go, this is what God would have me do right now. Now, some of the times in my life, I've known exactly what that was. And most times on paper and in my mind, financially, it didn't make any sense maybe. Or in terms of my comfort, it didn't make any sense. In terms of my wife's comfort, it didn't make any sense. But that's what God would have me do. Other times I look at it and I go, well, this is easy. I'll just throw $100 at this and that'll fix it. And that's never the answer either. That's a mind situation that the heart hadn't been engaged to go, let's look at this thing and then re-engage the mind to say, is this the best use of the resources and the talents and the gifts and the spiritual gifts God's given me? So all of those things have to be taken into consideration. So I use the word stewarding. I actually don't think that's a word, but I coined that word this week. Stewarding toward wisdom. Being a good steward in the wisdom God has given you. And you know, one of the things God promises us that if we ask for, He'll give us is wisdom. That's a promise. If you'll actually pray for God and you're serious to give you wisdom, He'll give you wisdom. Isn't that good news? If you don't leave out of here with anything else tonight but that, you got something really good tonight. Proverbs is full of text telling us that we ought to care for the poor and the needy. If you just read the Proverbs, we see it over and over and over again. Let's look at just one or two here. Proverbs 6, however, offers wisdom concerning laziness and the financial ruin that inevitably results. So if I'm enabling laziness, am I contributing to that? Yeah, I think we are. So we can't be enabling laziness because the Bible warns us against that. We are told to consider the industrious ant who works to store up food for itself. The passage also warns against sleeping when we should be working at something profitable. A sluggard is a lazy, slothful person, according to this text, who would rather rest than work. His end is assured, poverty and want. Mentoring and stewarding quite often is teaching somebody a different set of habits. Habits. Quite often people I've found that have this habit of laziness and slothfulness, it's not just because it's a part of their nature. It's because that's the way, the example that they had when they were growing up. They don't have a work ethic because they never had anybody in the home that showed a work ethic. And so they don't have that built in. You see a lot of fatherless homes with young men growing up in those homes that don't have any father as an example. And while they may see a mother that's very industrious, they need that fatherly example. So when I was in college, I was in the Big Brother program. You all familiar with Big Brother program? I was in the Big Brother program. I had a little brother that was retarded, and he didn't have a father in the home. And he only had a capacity to learn to a certain level. But one of the things I was most pleased with when I left college and I essentially left my relationship with him was that he had got involved in scouting and a whole lot of other things, that he had learned to be an industrious person to the full capacity that he had. It wasn't a lot, but he what he could do, he would do. And he didn't have that habit before I got assigned to be his big brother. And that's something we need to be looking at here. Are we stewarding toward a relationship where somebody actually has the opportunity to become better at being just industrious, so that we can teach that? A mentoring stewardship costs more than throwing money at a problem. I've hit that several times already. And it is a whole lot less trouble to throw money at something than it is to actually mentor somebody. And what the lesson there for any kind of ministry is this. The lesson there for ministry is that quite often there's not an easy way out when it comes to ministry. It's not like you go, okay, what's the shortest distance between two points? Because quite often God's got you going from A to Z by way of Q, which is in Paris or Singapore or someplace, or harder yet, in Africa. You know, that's what he has you doing. He has you going, you know, I was in North Carolina. I was going to end up in pastoring a church in North Carolina, and yet I thought I was going to Africa. I sold everything I had, and we booked up to go to Africa. And then suddenly that whole rug was just pulled out from under us, and we stood there and went, okay, now God, what? Where are we to go now? And I got the hardest assignment I've ever had as a pastor in the first church I ever pastored. I mean, it was tough. No doctrine had been taught in 33 years. None. And everybody just kind of enjoyed being together with the family. And there was no ministry taking place. There was nothing being taught of God. The last 6 months the pastor was there before I got there, it was a beautiful building, very Gothic, and there had these big arched stained glass windows that dated back to the late 1800s. I mean, it was beautiful, absolutely gorgeous. But the last 6 months the pastor was there, he preached on the windows that were in the church and who the families were that gave them and who they were, and about a little girl that got run over by a milk wagon. And for 6 months, Jesus wasn't mentioned a time. And you come in after that, it's hard work, isn't it, Pastor? That's hard work. But ministry is hard work. And mentoring is a whole lot more difficult than throwing money at something. Pearls before swine. Do not cast your pearls before the swine is a portion of the Sermon on the Mount. And to understand its meaning, we have to understand its context and placement within the sermon. Christ had just finished instructing the crowd on judgment and reproof. And here's the words: do not judge, or you too will be judged. For the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Now, that's the scripture that a lot of people can quote, even if they're not churchgoers. Don't judge me. Jesus said so. Don't judge me. And you hypocrite, take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will clearly see to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Then in verse 6, Christ tempers these admonitions and shows us a difference between judgment and discernment. Here's what it says. He says, when you take that plank out of your brother's eye, then you don't throw pearls before swine. What do you got to do to judge whether something's a swine or not? You got to make a judgment. You got to be discerning. Do not let a dog return to its vomit. What do you got to make a decision on? What are dogs? So you've got to be discerning. So he tells us in one sense, don't judge. In another sense, he's saying, be discerning about these things. Be careful about where you spend your time, energy, and efforts. Don't just necessarily throw money at the problem. Figure out where those resources ought to go and how you ought to spend your time in ministering to people. Conversely, there is another part of the verse. He who is oppressed, who oppresses the poor, shows contempt for their maker. Proverbs 17:5. Proverbs is in fact filled with scriptures that clearly show that God loves the poor and is offended when his children neglect them. Consequences for ignoring the plight of the poor are also made clear in Proverbs. If a man shuts his ears to the cries of the poor, he too will cry out and not be answered. And a note to the strong, with strong language, he who closes his eyes to the poor receives my curses. Among the many sins of Sodom described in Genesis 19 were her people's arrogance. They were overfed, unconcerned, and they did not help the poor and needy. So there is a very real call on our Christian nature and Christ in us to fulfill the call of taking care of the needy. Again, I say to you, it's how do we do that? How do we solve problems rather than contribute to them? How do we really solve problems rather than just fill a gap for a moment in time? Those are the real issues. So here's Matthew 7, verse 6. Do not give what is holy to dogs, nor cast pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces. This is the warning right after Jesus has said, don't judge, lest you'll be judged. So he is saying we're not to bring certain judgments on people lightly, but we are to be discerning about how we do spend our resources and our energy and effort. Can I say that any different than that, to where you can get it? Is everybody with me here? Okay. So the question is discernment or judgment. In sending out the 12, Jesus said to them, behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Head and heart, where we started, head and heart. Wise as a serpent, but harmless as a dove. Gentleness, respect, but with a lot of discernment and wisdom. Don't go out and just give yourself to the world without thinking, without reasoning, without talking to those people. Don't be undiscerning about how you give yourself, because you're responsible not to me or the church, you're responsible to God. It is God that has given you that day. There are wolves even among the poor. Has everybody figured that out? You know, y'all here are around a whole lot more street people and poor folks than we were back in North Carolina. I had to go downtown Charlotte to see what I see here on the streets every day. But you don't have to do that long till you figure out there are those that will take advantage of you. I know that's a shock to all of you, but there are. There are people that will take advantage of you. And there are people that will rob you. Listen to me real carefully. There are people that will rob you of the gifts God has given you to make good for in His kingdom. The gifts God has given you are to be used for His kingdom, and yet they can be wasted on those that are wolves in sheep's clothing. They are among the poor, they are among the wealthy. There's no financial statement for wolves in the scriptures that I found. Both are there. So here's the instructions concerning fellow believers. The question was asked, well, is this just for believers or is it for everybody? Well, so far we've seen the text are pretty much open to taking care of the poor and needy, but we are to be discerning in how we do that. What I'm giving you here tonight is a perfect example of why you look at all of the Word of God and not just one verse. Because all of this is involved in helping make the decision about that one verse. Do you see what I'm saying here? All of this has to do with your stewardship. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother, who? His brother, that's your fellow believer, in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with action and in truth. So we are called on to take care of our brothers and sisters. Now, I have found that it is very helpful to have a church body like we've got to sit down and analyze how some of those resources are to be used. I just had a resource given to me that I now have a little chunk of money that I have the responsibility to make sure is distributed as God would have me distribute it. And here's what that person said to me. Would you take this responsibility of making sure that this is distributed where it is most needed? I need your help. Now, I've spent a lot of time in prayer. I've prayed with people back in North Carolina over this. I've already set aside some that I'm going to be using to send kids to camp next year. We're going to spend a lot of time with the association talking about how we can make the camp better. We had some issues this year. And I'm going to enlist some of these younger guys to come alongside, bringing some younger people in this church that we can see benefit by sending them to camp in a Christian environment where they can hear guys like Pastor Tom teach them the Word of God. And they can go have an experience with God in an environment that is what it ought to be. They don't have to go back home at night and face the rigors of a home life that's not healthy. And so I've already set some aside for that. So here's the responsibility we have, though. We do have a responsibility to our brothers and sisters to make sure they're cared for, that there's not a need there that is overlooked. We've got some younger guys coming into the church now. You know what? If some of the ones that are older in this congregation have a bunch of stopped up gutters at their house, these young bucks should be stepping up and going, we'll take care of that. If we've got somebody with mechanic skills and somebody has a need to fix a car, we should go to that widow or orphan and we should say, we'll take care of that. So that's the responsibility of the body. And within the body, that is our first call of responsibility, is within the body of Christ. So here's our stewardship. Skills, special skills you've got. Some of you do things that I have no ability to do. Pastor Tom and I do things that some of you have no ability to do. That's part of what the body of Christ is coming together, but we should analyze what are the skills, the spiritual gifts, and the time that we're given, the resources we're given, the money we're given. Elvis said it best back here this afternoon. As we look around at what God's doing through you guys that are going out of here every week, Farron and Carol and Linda and Elva particularly, that are going out of here every week doing the hard work of the street work, and those that are coming to the care team, communication team, Sandy and Jane and all the rest of that group that's helping with that, that is working together in such a way that God is being glorified. And then you've got the clothing distribution for the toddlers back here, that cards are going in bags, and you go, well, what good is that? You're sticking a card in a bag, they're throwing it away when they get home. Well, we already had two walk in the door that came as a result of somebody sticking a card in a bag. I don't know who will show up here for the Why Conference, but it won't be because I did a whole lot on the street. It'll be because these people did a whole lot on the street. They took their gifts and their skills and their ability and their time and they invested into God's kingdom. And that's what we ought to be doing. So that's stewardship. So let me talk a little bit about liberation theology. And this is a little bit of a side, but I don't want you to get caught up in some of this stuff and not recognize it for what it is. Some of you have heard of some of these people, James Cone, Cornell West, Jeremiah Wright. You might have heard of Jeremiah Wright, the pastor for Obama before he became president. You've heard him on television, I'm sure. They're all part of a thing called Black Liberation Theology. Now, it did not start in this country with black folks. It started in South America with Latin American folks. And it was a poor group of Latin American people, Latinos in Latin America, that started this theological position that says this. It's a movement that attempts to interpret Scripture only through the plight of the poor. So it's like looking at Scripture, and instead of doing exegesis, which I've talked to you about before, the literal, historical, grammatical interpretation, everything is looked at through the eyes and the lenses of poverty. Now you will come up with very different meaning of Scripture if you do that rather than interpret Scripture through correct hermeneutics. If you look at things through the eyes of the poor, then everything that's written in the Bible, they say, is literally an instruction from God for everybody to take care of poor folks. That's what the whole liberation theology is about. It is to work toward a just society. You've heard of this whole thing of redistribution of wealth. That's where this whole idea became a theological idea. A just society in liberation theology says all funds are equally distributed, all housing is equally distributed, all everything is equally distributed. And everything in Scripture is looked at through those eyes, through those lenses. Jesus, who was poor himself, focused on the poor and the downtrodden, and any legitimate church will give preference to those who have historically been marginalized or deprived of their rights. That's their idea. That if a poor person comes into the church, they should take total priority over everything and everybody else. Now, we've had poor people come into this church since I've been here that wanted to take over this pulpit and wanted to take over this stage with regard to the music. And I wouldn't allow it. I don't know them. I don't know what their spiritual condition is. I have nothing against their poverty. I do have something against just letting anybody take over a pulpit or the stage. But they would say, if they come in here and they're experiencing poverty, we ought to stop everything and turn this over to them. That's one of the results, not the impetus, but the results of liberation theology. Defending the rights of the poor is seen as the central aspect of the gospel. If you see through the lenses of that being the central theme of the gospel message rather than spiritual salvation, can you see where that might take us in different roads? If your whole ministry is seen as the central aspect of the gospel is taking care and defending the rights of the poor, and it's not about sharing Christ and sharing the gospel message and the good news of salvation, then your ministries will take a different direction, will they not? Y'all with me? Okay. James Cone is the guy that took this from Latin America and brought it to this country and made it a black liberation theology. And it's mainly a theology that sees God as concerned with the poor and the weak. Cornel West is a guy that if you've ever seen him on television, he's a black professor, and his hair just goes everywhere. He sort of looks like, just goes everywhere, and he's got a little goatee, and he's on television a lot, but he is a professor, and if you ever hear him talk, this is where he's coming from. He was involved with James Cone in setting up the black liberation movement in this country. Jeremiah Wright is a result of that. And when I went to Africa time before last, I did several conferences all over southern Africa from Cape Town up to Johannesburg and over to the coast of Durban. And my theme was black liberation theology because it's one of the main problems that South Africa right now has. Is they're coming out of black liberation theology, and I taught on this and to a great extent, and guess who was mad at me? When I came off the stage. It was the white folks. The black folks went, "You're exactly right. That's where we've been. We need help getting out of this mess. We need to get back to the gospel." But it was the white folks that went, "You're just trying to give them an excuse." I said, "No, I'm not giving them an excuse. I want to give them a way out of this mess." So this is where they've been, though. And Anthony Penn says this, "God's presence in the world is best depicted through God's involvement in the struggle for justice," meaning equality for everybody across the board. Then there's a poverty gospel. This is quite different than the liberation gospel or the liberation theology. The poverty gospel, God wants you to be sick and poor. That's what they believe. God wants everybody to be sick and poor. Now, we're going to hit on a little bit of this when we do the Why Conference of dealing with evil. But because there are people that think that God's chosen people are the poor and the sick, and that he actually has set them aside to inherit the kingdom. And as far as the way I read my Bible, I just don't see that. I see the ones that accept Jesus as inheriting the kingdom. Rich, poor, in between, black, white, male, female, child, old person. Across the board, it's about Jesus, and it's about him as Savior. But this takes quite a different view. God wants you, it says, to be sick so that you will learn to obey his word. This theory or gospels also says, before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. It was me, and this is directly from the Psalms, but they're reading this out of context. It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. I know, Lord, that your laws are righteous and that in faithfulness you have afflicted me. Now, what is the context of that? Go back and look. What is the context of Psalm 119? And you'll begin to see God is using an affliction here to bring somebody to himself. Let me ask you this, for everybody sitting here personally. How many of you have learned something profoundly spiritual in your life as a result of affliction or poverty or sadness? How many of us? All of us have. It's a reality. It's a reality that we learn more in those situations than we do when we're doing great. But it's not God's will that we stay there. But if you take that little piece of Scripture, verses 67 to 75, and you take them out of the context, you've got a very different picture of that. God wants you to be sick because it demonstrates his power. That's the theme here. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in the flesh, Paul said. Remember that text? Okay. They said that's where God wanted to keep Paul. No, God was teaching Paul a lesson. I've learned some really profound lessons laying on my back in bed unable to get out. But I don't believe it was God's desire for me to live in that bed the rest of my life. Their position is that's exactly where God wants you. All the time. Not because you can learn a lesson and get up and do something about it, but because that's where he wants you. So you've got both of these. You've got the liberation theology movement, which says that we're supposed to equal everything out and take care of everybody that falls into that category, whether it's Latino or black or whatever it is. And then you've got the poverty gospel that says all of us are supposed to be sick and poor. Now, so if you've got somebody that's really celebrating the poverty gospel, they don't want your help. If you've got somebody that is celebrating a liberation theology, whether it's black, Latino, white, whatever it is, then they want your help, but they're going to continue to want your help. And what God's showing us is in between these and aside from these, there is real ministry to be done with people that are hurting, that have find themselves where they are for all kinds of reasons, and the body of Christ is to come around them and to secure them and to lift them up and to help them make better of themselves. And if we're not doing that, then the question, I was going to go right back to where we started tonight, am I empowering somebody or am I enabling somebody? How am I using the gifts God has given me? Am I being a good steward of all the things we've talked about tonight in making decisions on how I'm going to reach out in the community? Now, we've got a community we can go out to, and we could find ourselves giving and giving and giving and giving every day. And we can find ourselves not only just spinning our wheels, but spending what God has given us in order to minister to this community in a way that really is palatable. one of the many reasons I wanted to have this Why conference is because a lot of the stuff I was hearing on the street, well, you know, it's poor pitiful me, and God doesn't care, and God's out there somewhere, and he doesn't really care about me, and I'm not even sure he exists anymore, and what I need is a handout. And if you're a good Christian, you'll give me that. I've actually had people tell me that on the streets of Garberville. If you're a good Christian, you'll give me that. The question is, for all of us, should we take care of those in poverty? We ought to. It isn't should we take care of those that need a help in learning, like my little friend that was my little brother. We need to. The question is, how do we do that using the resources we've been given by God as he builds this church? Because it is, the scriptures tell us, it's Christ that builds the church. How do we use all the resources God is bringing in here, the gifts, the talents, the abilities? The ladies that sit down around that table and write cards out, and a person gets it and opens it and can't believe they got mail that day, and somebody actually sent them a card and cries and weeps tears of joy over a card that somebody sent them because somebody thought about them. And normally it's somebody like Jane sitting back there that goes, I know this person that's brokenhearted, and they just don't have a lot of people that are loving on them, and they could use somebody just to say, I love you. And somebody goes out and follows up on that and finds somebody like Carol did this past week that goes, do you have a Bible? Can I look these scriptures up that are on this card? Are they in that Bible? Can I look them up? Would you bring me a Bible that has those scriptures in it? And we got somebody that's donated Bibles back here, so yeah, we got Bibles. And that person has told me, when you run out, let me know. I'll get you some more. That's God's resources coming together with God's gifts and talents and abilities and spiritual gifts, and the heart and the mind to come together to go out and make it happen. You know, as I talked to David O about going into the prison, and we're getting real close to getting to the time that we're going to go do that, I hope the paperwork will be back from the state this week, that when we go do that, and I know because Elvin and I have done prison ministry before, there's a whole lot of guys there that'll just love to pull the wool over your eyes. And there's a lot of guys at the mission that want to just pull the wool over your eyes. You know? Well, I might be a sheep, but I ain't a dumb sheep. And I do have the Holy Spirit living in me to help me be discerning about how I spend the gifts and abilities and the spiritual gifts that he's given me. I've got all of that. And sometimes all I'm crying out for you to do tonight is this, is don't get your heart before your head or your head before your heart. Engage both of those to analyze what it is God's putting in front of you. And is this a temptation to be diverted, or is it a legitimate call of ministry? Listen to me very carefully right now. Please listen to what I'm going to say. If it is legitimately a ministry that we're not doing in this church, please, let me beg you, please don't just jump out there and do it yourself. Please don't. Can I say it one more time? Please don't. Come back to this body. Bring it like Janelle did to me first about the clothing for the children. I then took it to the trustees and said, what do you guys think? So the church, now the whole church is involved, and you're not running like a renegade out there like the Lone Ranger. Here's what happens when that happens. When somebody just goes off and starts doing stuff, sometimes they're actually working against the ministries the church is doing or is about to do. I've actually had it work against me that somebody in the church that I'm pastoring comes out and starts doing something over here when our focus is supposed to be right here. And we prayed long and hard about where the focus is. And the whole ministry ought to work together like we're seeing this one work now. This church right now is a beautiful example of how ministry ought to work. It really is, folks. I am so proud of what God is doing in your lives. And I see it happening where the body's coming together, and in each part, as Ephesians 4 says, doing its part, coming together, beginning to integrate, and all those little pieces beginning to filter back through to make a difference. Because the pastors can't do it by themselves. Nobody in the church can. And that's why I've been saying to you for a year and a half now, soon to be 2 years, it's not just pastors that have a ministry. Everybody's got a ministry. But it ought to be orchestrated back through the body of Christ so that no one person is working against somebody doing something in the church, the overall work, nor are they doing something that the whole body ought to be involved in. If Janelle had just gone off and done that thing, let me tell you what would happen. She would have probably had a good turnout because she is masterful at social media. But we would not be seeing people integrate back into the church as we have the last couple of Sundays because of her work. We would not be seeing the integration between the outreach team and the communications team of the care ministry because each part's doing its part. Each part is functioning as they're gifted and trained to do. But anytime, I'm going to say it one more time and I want you to hear me, anytime somebody just picks up and sees something and jumps out there and starts to do it, the chances are very, very, very good they're working against the overall ministry goals rather than for them. And we need to be careful as we look at all of this stuff here. If you're really wise and you want to be wise as a serpent and gentle as a dove, bring those heartfelt ministries back to this body. First to me. I'm very likely to sit down with Pastor Tom and ask him, what do you think? Why? Because he's got more experience in this area right here than I do. He knows what's been tried and what's been done and what's worked and what hadn't worked, and he knows what God's doing right now. And between the two of us, we can pray about these things. Take them to the trustees. Trustees, here's what we need to do. Here's the resources we need to do it. We got the resources, we got the approval of the body, we've got the heart to get it done, we've got those that will step up in the ministry to get it done. And then all of this can come together because it's the discernment, not of one, but of the many, the entire body of leadership of this church. As we look at things that need to be done, how does the body see it being done? I talk to David O. how many times a week? Yeah, 20 or 30 times a week at least. And it's almost never this huge thing. It's fine-tuning what God's doing. It's saying, okay, what does God want us to do with this little thing here? Okay, well, what about this? Well, yeah, I think that matches up with God's word. Let's pray about that for a day or two. Or, yeah, I think that's how we need to handle it. Go ahead, let's do that. That's the way the body should work. So we're all coming together. We're contributing. We're contributing to our thoughts. We're contributing our ideas. It's no one person's ministry. It's all about Jesus. And we're seeing God work through this body in some ways like I've never seen him work through any church that we've been a part of. Because you all are stepping up and doing the hard work of ministry. Now, I'll tell you, we've done, in our church lives, we've done many bigger things than we're doing here. Huge things that made a splash. And we've done conferences like we're going to do here for the Why conferences where we had over a dozen speakers in the course of 3 days. And that takes a lot of planning and energy and effort. And we've seen people step up to speak. But let me tell you what's harder to have happen. What's harder to have happen are what y'all are doing. The hard work sitting around a table writing people. The hard work of going out and putting up the brochures and promoting this and getting it done. That we've always had problems with, and that's why I'm so terribly proud of what God's doing in y'all's lives. I'm so thankful that he has raised you guys up to do what you're doing. Because it shows me that it's not just the glory work. It's the tough stuff behind the scenes when you go out there for 4.5 hours when you don't feel well in the heat. That's not glory work. That's the hard work of ministry. But my prayer is this. My prayer is that you'll see some of those people walk in the door. My long-term prayer is that you'll see lives changed. And some of those lives may not be the direct result of who you handed that brochure to. It may be the result of who they talked to after they left here and you never saw them again. I remember an event we did in Colorado. We did it at the local high school, which is right across the street from our church. We had a guy come in from North Carolina who was a youth evangelist, and he is terrific. His name's Clayton King. You may hear him on the radio here. He's on the radio all over the world. He does a little 2-minute sound bite. So if you ever hear, "This is Clayton King. My 2 minutes today are," and he'll give you 2 minutes to think about something. Well, Clayton was coming to Colorado, and he is a terrific youth evangelist. And we did this big youth meeting at the high school, and there was this one kid that was just a brute. I mean, he was a brat. And everything Clayton said, he went, "That's hogwash." And then he started using some more colorful words than hogwash. And so he just screamed out loud, you know. Well, after it was over, Clayton told him at one point, says, "Young man, just shut your mouth, and when we get through here tonight, you can come up here, and I'll answer any question you got." So the kid did. To his credit, he came up afterwards. And so I'm standing there next to Clayton, and here's this kid, and he's a smart aleck, and he brings up 3 or 4 things, and Clayton very gently, very graciously, very humbly answers his questions. And when he got ready to leave, I handed him my card. And 3 years later, I got a call late one night from that kid. Never heard from him for 3 years. But I get a call from him, 10:30, 11 o'clock one night. And I couldn't remember him. I mean, he was explaining. And then finally he said, "You remember me. I kept saying, hogwash." I said, "Oh yeah, I got you. I remember you." 3 years. God continues to work. The guy had carried around my card in his wallet for 3 years. He had come up against a crisis in his life, and he was fumbling through his wallet, and there was my card. We don't ever know. You're not going to know till you get to heaven what good you've done the last couple of weeks. Those of you that sit and write cards, you're not fully going to know till you get to heaven what you've done. But you're getting a glimpse of it now. And those tears of joy that person shared with you, Jane, that's a glimpse God has given you to let you know that He is encouraging you to tell you that you're doing exactly what He'd have you to do. Those are joyful glimpses of what God's doing in your life. And you ought to appreciate every one of them. Love it. Enjoy it. Enjoy your faith. Have a good time with this. Get excited about seeing God work through you. And this whole thing that you think is such hard work, it's more difficult than laying in the Lazy Boy. It's also a lot more rewarding. Because one day there's going to be eternal rewards for what you're seeing happen right now. So I just wanted to let you know before we got out of here tonight how terrifically happy I am with what you guys are doing. And I see your work, and God sees your work. Be faithful to what He's called you to do and how He's gifted you. And I just believe we're going to see Him do terrific things here in this church, through this body, to this community, and far beyond.